Welcome to Rewind. We're here at Doha's Museum of Islamic Art to mark 10 years since the launch of Al Jazeera English by revisiting some of our best documentaries from the past decade. This week, we return to the Somali famine in 2011, when hundreds of thousands of people starved to death, an overwhelming number of them small children. Al Jazeera's fault lines travelled to Somalia to investigate how food aid was being withheld by Western governments, and early warning signs of famine were ignored. Later, I'll be discussing the fallout of that famine with an expert on food security in the region. But first, here's Crisis in the Horn of Africa, Somalia's famine.
It's the second child he's had to bury in Dadaab.
Another one of his sons. When did the other one die?
5 days ago.
5 days ago? In another grave? Can he show us? You can see the number of fresh graves that are here. They say there are 25 people buried in this area. Most of them have died in the last 2 weeks. And they're saying that many people in this part of the camp have fallen ill to measles. This is the same man's son, yeah? He looks really sick. How long has he been in this condition?
20 days.
In the 21st century, how could this have happened? And if famine is man-made, who is responsible? Fault Lines is travelling as close to the heart of the crisis as we can get in order to find out. This is what 20 years of civil war and no government can do to a capital once considered one of the most beautiful in Africa. Mogadishu is now the most dangerous city in the world. And yet, as in Dadaab, Somalis from famine-hit regions are taking huge risks to travel here and seek refuge amid the conflict and armed militias. Like the international aid organizations trying to respond to this crisis, Somalia's chaos means there are limits to how we'll be able to operate. Like many international organizations, Mogadishu is also the closest our team can get to the regions where famine has been declared. That's because in those rural areas in the south of the country, Al-Shabab fighters remain in control. The group, which was terror-listed by the US government and has links to Al-Qaeda, has banned many Western aid organizations from working in its territory. Some Al-Shabaab spokesmen have even denied there is famine there. Those are the basic realities. The most severe drought in 60 years. 4 million Somalis facing starvation. A hardline Islamist armed group preventing some international aid from getting in. And families having to travel huge distances across front lines before receiving help. Access to the crisis is so bad that the UN says it doesn't know how many people have died, but that it's certainly in the tens of thousands, most of those children. Habiba Isaac Hassan has just arrived from the countryside. Her daughter, Markaba, lost 5 of her 7 infant children on the journey.
Does she think that the world understands what's going on here?
It's a catastrophe there, and there's no other way of describing it. It's the worst situation that we face anywhere.
The World Food Programme is the lead UN agency for responding to famine. It doesn't have operations in the south of the country where the famine has been at its worst.
So we have a number of operational requirements in terms of the way we provide assistance. A year and a half ago, we were unable to continue operating in southern Somalia, and Al-Shabab has so far not allowed WFP to operate in the areas that it controls.
With WFP's operations curtailed, the onus has fallen on smaller organizations and on local ones. Sa'id was founded by a group of Somali women in the early 1990s. By working at the neighborhood level and reaching across the clan lines that have often divided Somalia in the past, it's been able to function throughout the city, even in areas controlled by Al-Shabaab.
This organization distributes food every day in all 16 districts of Mogadishu. At each site, they're feeding 5,000 people. That means 80,000 people every single day.
Sa'id says the international community should have seen this crisis coming.
The first red flags went up for Sa'id, for example, in the third week of December.
Tony Burns is the group's operational director. He's been working on the ground for Sa'id since 1998.
We indicated at that time we were seeing significant numbers of new internally displaced people entering Mogadishu from rural areas. As those messages, those flags went up the chain of command, they got filtered out and ignored, essentially. So while there was pre-positioning in Ethiopia and Kenya and in northern Somalia, there was no pre-positioning in southern Somalia.
When images of the crisis started coming out, donors were forced into action. But for aid organizations in Somalia, there are strict international regulations on giving out food, regulations that persist even in the midst of a famine.
You can see how much precision these guys are putting into this to make sure that each sack weighs as much as it's supposed to. That's indicative of how much pressure there is on aid distribution organizations to make sure that none of the food they receive is going missing.
In an effort to deprive Al-Shabaab of funding, in 2009, the US Office of Foreign Assets Control, or OFAC, imposed sanctions.
The requirement was effectively to ensure that individuals were not in contravention of U.S. Law concerning support, material support or other assistance to terrorist-affiliated organizations.
The OFAC rules have meant that organizations with U.S. funding or handling U.S. aid must account for every last gram of food to prove it's not being diverted to Al-Shabaab or risk being prosecuted by the U.S. government. Even at this treatment center for malnourished babies, accountability for every item was an obvious priority.
The empty wrappers that we've seen being returned is really evidence that the mothers have to show that they've given the food supplement to their children. But it's also a way that the aid organizations can show and verify that they've actually distributed aid to people rather than it ending up in the black market or potentially in the hands of Al-Shabaab.
Sa'id told us the OFAC rules made it risky to consider extending their operations beyond Mogadishu.
It's incredibly intimidating. We take our mandate to the Somali population very seriously. But the legal ramifications and the financial ramifications to an organization that has no recurring funding are at this point enormous, to the point that we may have to walk away, even in a famine.
With a full-blown famine clearly unfolding, in August, Washington said it was relaxing the rules.
The OFAC regulations have clearly been modified to reflect an evolving situation, and those OFAC licenses have been opened and granted to some 12 international organizations to be able to operate in south-central Somalia.
But by the time the rules were changed, some 29,000 children under the age of 5 had died from starvation. The malnutrition has been most severe among infant children. 18-month-old Mohammed Abshal Omar had escaped the famine zone 3 days before we met him at the end of September. His mother, Asha, told us there was still no aid reaching her town.
Dadkii soo qaadi waayay leen kaas meesh ku heli kara oo sida xaas dad badan oo awood ay isku soo qaadan aan leen maayeen dadkii kale oo iska fudud sideeda camal waa soo baxayaan الدك أو حاسك أو عاد أو حلس سو بحكي عن دكاس.
Why do you think this wasn't done earlier if there was an acknowledgement that there was going to be a crisis on this scale?
You know, quite frankly, the demand surged as the crisis surged, and that's when we moved. But again, I want to be very clear that never did those sanctions stipulate that you can't provide assistance to Somalia. I think that's been an interpretation, but that's an inaccurate interpretation.
But by the end of 2010, U.S. humanitarian aid to Somalia had dropped by almost 90% of what it was before the OFAC sanctions were imposed, as the drought struck and famine loomed.
There was a time when the pipeline of WFP was really bad, and the reason was because the United States was not quite sure whether the food that comes is also benefiting the terrorists.
Aid levels didn't rise again until famine was officially declared in July.
Has there been a decision by this administration to attempt to destabilize Al-Shabaab by cutting aid to those areas that are under their control?
We think that Al-Shabaab is a destabilizing force inside of Somalia.
But we're talking about 4 million people now facing starvation.
Al-Shabaab is a problem, and it constitutes a serious terrorist threat.
Clearly, it was a U.S. political decision not to allow their resources into South and Central Somalia, and understanding that the U.S. has historically been the most generous and the largest donor and partner for South and Central Somalia, it has made a systemic difference.
Obviously, this OFAC policy has cost lives. The question is, how many thousands of lives has it cost?
So what we have done here in the United States and elsewhere is to partner in a very bizarre way with Shabaab in punishing the local population.
For our organization and for our staff, it's a sense of failure that this has occurred again, that they've tried their best. We've looked for ways to raise these flags with the international community, and nothing has happened.
Does it make you angry?
Yes, but there's nothing we can do. We're on the bottom.
The American embassy in Mogadishu hasn't been functional since Somalia's last great famine. In the early 90s, some 300,000 people starved as conflict between rival warlords blocked aid delivery to the south. The US led a UN force to open the aid routes. An offensive against the warlord in control of Mogadishu turned into a fatal battle, and his militias shot down two Black Hawk helicopters. 18 American soldiers were killed.
There hasn't been a permanent US mission here in Mogadishu for many years now, but some say it was the Black Hawk Down incident in 1993 that started the US disengagement from Somalia. This former embassy is now home to more than 16,000 Somali IDPs.
For some, what remains here has come to symbolize the neglect with which the US treated Somalia throughout the late 1990s. Just 5 years later, after the US embassy bombings in Kenya and Tanzania, and after 9/11, U.S. interest resurged. William Bellamy was the U.S. ambassador to Kenya from 2003 to 2006.
And indeed, Al-Qaeda in East Africa was an active and very dangerous presence. And I think there's no doubt that at that point, 2003, 2004, 2005, the overriding focus of U.S. policy was on dealing with that particular threat.
As the CIA cultivated relationships with rival warlords they thought would help fight the rise of what they saw as radical Islamism, a new political formation took control and brought law and order to Mogadishu. The Union of Islamic Courts, with Al-Shabaab as its military wing.
I think it was a fairly well thought out policy at the time, but it was in the end ultimately not a successful one.
But the choices made next were to make things even worse.
I'm absolutely confident that if the Ethiopians did not invade Somalia, Shabaab would have remained a very small fragment of the Union Islamic Courts.
I think the problem of the Islamic Courts Union is it was overtaken by radicals, right? It was overtaken by the East Africa Al-Qaeda cell, right? And it was overtaken by the military arm of the Islamic Courts Union.
In the summer of 2006, Washington backed Somalia's neighbor and sworn enemy, Ethiopia, in a full-scale invasion and occupation to rid the country of Al-Shabaab. Jendayi Fraser was the State Department's senior official for Africa at the time.
I think that's really misunderstood. It's claimed that we supported them, we even pushed them in. In fact, myself and Secretary Rice were on the phone with Prime Minister Malis, urging him not to go into Somalia.
But you supported it with air support and military support after the fact, right?
Yeah, true. Intelligence support, primarily. Not military support, intelligence support. In other words, where we had intelligence about certain targets that were high-value targets to the United States, we certainly made sure that they understood where those targets were.
The horror of the Ethiopian invasion was really its occupation of Mogadishu for so many years. Not only did it destroy the Somali economy, it threw so many people out of their homes, it catapulted the Shabab to power.
The 1.5 million people who were displaced by the Ethiopian occupation, which was supported by the United States, which ultimately gave birth to the dominance of Al-Shabaab. That's the genealogy, if you like, of the current famine.
There are still foreign troops in Mogadishu, but today they're from Uganda and Burundi. The Ethiopians have been replaced by an African Union mission of more than 9,000 soldiers. Washington provides logistical support, including weapons, equipment, even funds for private military contractors from DC-based firm Bancroft, who advise and train AMISOM forces. 6 weeks before fault lines arrived, Al-Shabaab fighters withdrew from much of the city.
We're driving to a neighborhood in the north part of the city where African Union troops are having daily engagement with Al-Shabaab fighters. So far, we've only seen the neighborhoods which have been taken back from where Al-Shabaab used to occupy. Now, we're going to the front line.
While AMISOM is fighting by conventional means in Mogadishu, and Kenyan and Ethiopian troops have invaded to secure buffer zones on their borders, the Obama administration has ramped up drone attacks in southern Somalia. They have reportedly killed key Al-Shabaab leaders. In the fortified trench on Mogadishu's edge, a senior commander tells us AMISOM is now in control of 95% of the city.
Do you think there are even now Shabaab coming in and out?
Yeah, you cannot rule out that one, because they are Somalis, they are citizens of this country. They can move in civilian clothes. We do have them, they must be there. But intelligence, TFG intelligence has been picking one by one, and the police, they have been picking them. Yeah.
Just 2 weeks later, a suicide truck bombing outside a government compound killed dozens. Al-Shabaab has claimed responsibility and pledged a new campaign of guerrilla tactics against the transitional federal government. Within the TFG's motley army, the US has found some uneasy allies. During the 90s, Inda Ade controlled the Lower Shabelle region in the south, where he was feared for his brutality. By 2006, he was part of the Union of Islamic Courts, and his militias were at the service of Al-Shabaab and Al-Qaeda. But he's changed sides again. A general in the Somali National Army, he now gets his weapons from AMISOM.
What does it feel like for you to be fighting on the other side now? Because you were initially fighting on the side that he's describing as Al-Shabaab and Al-Qaeda. And do you think they find that unacceptable, the CIA?
In light of the TFG's weakness, the US has shifted course again. backing any political figure, warlord or district commissioner, who they believe will serve as a buffer against Al-Shabaab. In Mogadishu, the impact of two decades of failed international policy have made it difficult to respond. At Banadir Hospital, the pediatrics ward is overwhelmed with tiny children, starving, dehydrated, suffering from acute diarrhea. The room reflects the new geopolitical dynamics of the famine response. Islamic aid organizations are filling in where UN and Western groups can't or won't go. Alongside Somali staff, they're racing to save three-month-old Asha's life. As they do what they can to beat back death, the rest of the world is moving on, casting our gaze and pointing our cameras elsewhere.
It's Shabab, it's the United States, it's the transitional federal government, it's the United Nations Office for Somalia. All of these are partners to the policies and politics that produce the famine.
Earlier, I had a chance to speak to food security expert Nisar Majid. Such a hard-hitting film we've seen just there. Nisar, you've studied this famine in depth. Let's start by looking at the beginning, those early warning systems that were in place a year before this catastrophe hit. Why weren't they heeded?
Well, I mean, that's one of the biggest, most important questions. In the end, the reason why they weren't heeded was due to this tension between the humanitarian imperative to assist people and then the political complications and the security complications around the presence of Al-Shabaab.
I mean, the film says pretty conclusively that it was at least partly the US's counter-terrorism policies that were to blame for preventing much of the aid from reaching south and central parts of Somalia where Al-Shabaab operated. I mean, do you agree with that assessment?
Well, I think no one really comes out of this situation very well at all. I mean, you can blame many different parties. Al-Shabaab's presence on the ground itself, of course, was part of the problem, and then the antagonistic relationship between Al-Shabaab and the international community, and certainly the presence of specific legislation by the US government was a major hindrance. It was a major kind of restriction on creating, making available resources and giving aid organisations the opportunity to go in. And really it was only with the declaration of the famine in July, which was about 2 months after the peak of the famine actually was taking place, or the peak of deaths were happening, that a waiver was introduced by the US government, which then cleared the way, if you want, for a surge of assistance to hit the ground.
Nisar, just now we're getting warnings from some 38 aid agencies of 5 million people in Somalia, again facing acute food shortages due to drought. What are the chances that we're going to see a repeat of the Somalia famine of 2011?
The situation remains extremely complicated. You still have Al-Shabaab controlling large parts of southern Somalia, and you still have an atmosphere, a difficult operating environment where counter-terrorism legislation and the threat of legal action is in place, and where there's a very kind of risk-averse international community who are worried about legal threats, they're worried about reputational threats by their resources being diverted into the wrong hands.
So those lessons haven't been learned. Sorry to interrupt, but just crucially, because that was such a crucial part of the film, that the US's OFAC policies haven't changed even after everything we saw there.
Well, they haven't changed, but the question then is whether, depending on the situation on the ground, whether there would be a waiver introduced in sufficient time, and everything depends really on the preparedness, the planning of international agencies, and whether they have learnt, in fact, the lessons of 2011. But the situation remains very complicated, and the political issues are always take precedence in the end, and it depends on how those dynamics play out.
That's quite a somber thought to end on. Nisar Majid, thank you very much for taking the time to be with us here on Rewind. And that's it for this week. For more on this story, do visit aljazeera.com/rewind or share your thoughts with us at facebook.com/AJ Rewind. Till the next time, goodbye.